Hello everyone, and welcome to week 9 of English 120. This week you're going to be reading The Call of the Wild. Read chapter 3, The Dominant Primordial Beast, and participate in the discussion forum where we'll be analyzing that chapter. Please also complete the research module, evaluating the credibility and appropriateness of sources, and take the quiz at the end. Remember, your grade is based on the best of 2 times that you take that quiz. Understand how to write research questions, which I'll be going over in this lecture. Understand the research project, which I'll also be going over in this lecture, and then complete your research prospectus assignment. You will have 2 weeks to complete this assignment. So let's go back to Buck in The Call of the Wild. Please actively read the 3rd chapter of The Call of the Wild, by Jack London, The Dominant Primordial Beast, and then answer the following questions in this week's discussion forum. Please support your answer with quotations from the text and respond to at least 3 of your peers' posts. You will be required to post your own response by this Saturday at 11:59 p.m., and you'll be required to respond to your peers' posts by Tuesday at 11:59 p.m. So please describe Spitz's character using examples from the chapter to support your answer. So who is Spitz, and why does Buck feel the way he does about Spitz? How do Francois and Perrault display their true natures in this chapter? Give specific examples to support your answer. How does Buck begin to undermine Spitz's authority in this chapter? What were the effects of Buck's actions? What does this say about Buck's transformation from a Southland dog? In the following quotation, what does London mean by the dominant primordial beast? So that's the name of the chapter, so we should always pay attention to something that is called out in that way. A pause seemed to fall. Every animal was motionless, as though turned to stone. Only Spitz quivered and bristled as he staggered back and forth, snarling with horrible menace, as though to frighten off impending death. Then Buck sprang in and out, but while he was in, shoulder had at least squarely met shoulder. The dark circle became a dot on the moon-flooded snow as Spitz disappeared from view. Buck stood and looked on, the successful champion, the dominant primordial beast who had made his kill and found it good. So I want you to really talk about what is going on in this transformational moment. What kind of, what's happened? What does primordial mean? Look that up. And then what has happened to Buck in this moment? What traits have helped Buck thrive in his new world? Because, Buck was just a dog living on a farm until quite recently. Of them, which do you think is the most important and why? Finally, I want you to research the symptoms of rabies and the disease's treatment during the time of the Yukon Gold Rush. What would an outbreak of rabies mean to the dogs and to the trappers? All right, so those are your questions. Now, we're gonna be talking a little bit about our argumentative research paper. Your assignments for the rest of the semester in regards to writing are, you're gonna be writing a prospectus, you're gonna be writing a thesis outline and sources document, you're going to be writing your first draft of your argumentative research paper. You're going to be doing a peer and self-review of your argumentative research paper. And then you're going to turn in a final draft of your argumentative research paper. Please make sure when you choose a topic, it's something that you can find issues in, that you can argue a solution to. It's really important that this is argumentative. A lot of you in your compare and contrast essays did not argue one way or the other. So we are learning argumentative writing in this class. So make sure that when you create your thesis for this paper, that it is argumentative, okay? The format requirements are 8 to 10 double-spaced pages, Times New Roman 12-point font, MLA format, and we'll be talking about that in more detail, but it is something all of you need to work on. It's found in chapter 21 of The Bedford Researcher. The overall requirements are your paper must use at least 6 academic sources other than your textbook, either one of your textbooks, that are referred to using MLA in-text citations and that are listed on the Works Cited page at the end of your paper. Your paper must have an introduction where you introduce your topic and you have a focus thesis that clearly states the topic you're writing about and the position you are arguing about this topic. Your paper must contain several body paragraphs that introduce subtopics that are proven with evidence, and your paper must have a conclusion where you clearly state how you've proven your thesis and communicate the purpose of your paper. That's due not until, remember, the first draft of this paper is not due until the 2nd of May, but we're going to be working towards this. You guys turned in possible research topics 2 weeks ago, and I gave you input on them. If you have questions, please reach out to me and I will help you think more about your topic. But when you're thinking about your topic, remember you're comparing things as they were in the time when Jack London was living to how they are now. So to verify that you have an arguable topic and find a way towards a thesis statement, you write research questions. So a research question is a brief question that directs your effort to collect, critically read, and evaluate and take notes on your sources in order to lead you toward writing a successful argumentative research paper. It's your first step towards writing a thesis statement. A successful research question focuses on a specific issue that's arguable in an 8 to 10 page paper. And a successful research question begins with a question word like what, why, when, where, who, or how. So here's the first step. You have a topic. Now, what is the issue you want to write about? So for example, what is your topic? Maybe your issue is comparing the 1906, your topic is comparing the 1906 earthquake with a modern disaster such as the recent wildfires. What are 3 major issues you've defined about your topic? So you want to do this step after you've done some initial reading about your topic. So if you decided on doing this topic above, you should start by reading about your topic in encyclopedias, or in the case of this topic, the wildfires, which are very recent news, you want to look it up in newspaper articles. After reading these articles, brainstorm for 10 minutes to come up with 3 possible issues. When I did this, I came up with these possible issues: communication during a disaster, you know, the constraints and problems with communication during a natural disaster, natural disaster preparedness, and how the landscape of California and risk of natural disaster affects its inhabitants. I can check these to make sure they're arguable by seeing if they both have 2 sides. So definitely communication has 2 sides. Some people think it's good, some people think it's not good. Same thing with disaster preparedness. You could look at how it's changed over the years. And the landscape of California risk of natural disaster, its effects on its inhabitants, that might be more abstract and harder to do in an 8 to 10 page paper. But they are both complex enough to write a 8 to 10 page paper proving them. So you want to focus on some aspect of this issue. You can focus it to inform. Like you could take the role of kind of a reporter in the paper, and your question could be, what is known about the communication during the 1906 earthquake, and what is not known about that? Or how might we define disaster communication? So these aren't as really as good, but you can also create and share new knowledge. So what causes what were the effects of the wildfires in October 2017 in Napa and Sonoma County? What could prevent future wildfires, or what could prevent future earthquakes? These are ways you can start thinking about it. What preventative measures can be taken to reflect? What are the implications of? How can we learn from the example of an individual? To evaluate what conclusions merited or not have writers and readers already made about this topic, okay? Go through these and try them out and start sticking in the issues that you've defined to see if they work in these types of questions. These are frameworks for you to develop your own questions. So after that, you want to generate your own sample questions, okay? They can focus on what is known or not known about an issue, what's occurred in the past that's relevant to an issue, what conclusions have writers and readers already made about the issue, what do the writers and readers involved in the conversation about the issue want to see happen or not happen, outcomes, what has happened so far, what is likely to happen, what are the best procedures for carrying out actions, for making decisions. So use these as a way to draft your own research questions. You want to, after you've drafted a bunch of just kind of quick and easy questions, you want to choose a research question that seems most likely to help you achieve your purpose as a writer. That is to write a clear 8 to 10 page research paper that is argumentative. And then you want to refine your research question. So here's an example. If my original research question was, what should be done about steroid use by adolescent girls involved in competitive sports? One way to refine that to make it much more of a research question is to add in a conditional phrase, even though, add in something that I know already, right? That the reader knows already, and then add the question to it. So even though we know that widespread drug testing of all athletes, younger and older, is impossible, what should be done about steroid use by adolescent girls involved in competitive sports? Do you see how much more complex the refined question is than the original question? Please make sure that your one research question, when you refine it, contains one of these conditional words, as seen in the list on the slide. Then you just want to refine your question by deleting vague words and phrases and making sure you're using specific language. If there's specific language to what you're talking about, then you want to use that. All right, so you're doing all this work in order to have a research question for your research prospectus, which is due on the 28th of March. So what is a research prospectus? It's a proposal to undertake a research project. In this case, it's a proposal to undertake an 8 to 10 page research paper. Prospectus is a statement that briefly describes the questions, materials, methods, and research a researcher will use in his or her research. A prospectus indicates that the research project fits the required parameters. There is a detailed explanation about writing a proposal or research prospectus in Chapter 3 of The Bedford Researcher. So what are the parts of a prospectus? A prospectus contains a clear, concise introduction to the topic of the research. If you are writing about the 1906 earthquake and the recent wildfires, you need to give us background information about these two events and how they're related in order for us to understand what you're talking about. A prospectus states the main research question. So this is where you add in your research question that you've developed through the work you've done over the past week. A prospectus summarizes the basic arguments. So what are some of the arguments that people could make? A prospectus about this issue. Prospectus lists the basic research materials and methods if the researcher has already certain materials in mind. So you're going to be talking about how you're going to go to the library and you are going to do research in order to prepare for your research paper. And I'm sorry, the due date is incorrect on this slide, as you will see when you go into the actual assignment. Your assignment is, this prospectus is not due until the 4th, okay? The 4th of April, so do not panic. You have 2 weeks to complete this. How long should a prospectus be? A prospectus should be at least 4 pages long. More importantly, a prospectus needs to cover the basic points to assure the reader that the researcher plans a substantive project. Here are the steps to writing a prospectus. Decide on a tentative title for your prospectus. What are you researching, in one sentence or less? Let that inform your title. Consider applicable headings for your prospectus. You should minimally have headers for an introduction, research description, procedures, research justification, and works to be cited. These headings will help you to better organize your perspectives and will help explain your research to your audience. Continue to research and then write the introduction. Give a 1 to 2 paragraph history of your topic and give a brief explanation regarding what you are proposing to research and why. Develop one research question that you plan to answer in the course of your research. Write a research description section. Give a more specific description of your proposed research. There may be some overlap with the introduction, but will have less historical information and begin to describe the purpose of your study. Write a procedure section. Give an outline for your method of research. Describe your proposed techniques. Answer the when, where, and how of your study. If you already have materials in mind, add a preliminary works cited section. Show that you've already begun research and are knowledgeable about the topic. Show that others are also interested in the topic of your research. Conclude and edit your prospectus. Read over it, making sure that you have used appropriate words and sentence structures. Please proofread. All right, that's it for this week. I look forward to seeing you guys online. As always, please let me know if you have any questions.